Hello friends, I hope you enjoyed watching the last video where with the help of several activities, we understood the reflection of ourselves and the objects around us. If you remember, I saw my inverted image on the concave surface of the spoon and an erect image on the convex surface. You must also have made this effort at home. If not, then you should definitely try it.
A question came to my head that in the case of a convex mirror, we can place the objects in two positions only,
one at infinity and the other one is between the infinity and the pole. But in case of concave mirrors, will there be only two cases or more? Will the image formed be erect or inverted? Virtual or real? Let us try to find out the answers to these questions.
As we know that in case of concave mirror, all the points lie in the front. So we can make six different cases by placing the object at six different positions.
The object can be placed at infinity, beyond C, at C, between C and F, at F, and the last one is between F and P.
So let us see what will be the effect on the image when we place the object at these six positions.
To perform this activity, we need a concave mirror, a stand, a candle, a small white screen and a long strip of a chart. It is a concave mirror having a focal length of 20 centimeters. How much? 20 centimeters. So I will mark a point P on one side of this chart. What will we mark? Point P. If the focal length is 20 centimeters, then F must be at a distance of 20 cm, and we already know that the radius of curvature is twice the focus length. Then C can be marked at a distance of 40 cm from P. I will place the stand on P and the concave mirror on it. Case 1. If the candle is placed far away, say at infinity, and the screen somewhere in the middle of the candle and the mirror.
The screen should be moved back and forth until a sharp image is formed on the screen.
I get this point only when I put the screen at the focus. The size of the image is very small and we can see the image on the screen. So it is real.
Let's fill it in our observation table.
Case 2. If the candle is placed beyond C, then I'll get reflection on the screen when the screen is placed between F and C. Here as well. The size of the image is smaller than the object and real and inverted in nature. Case 3. If the candle is placed at C, then the image will also be formed at C. The size of the image will be the same as the candle, but the nature will be real and inverted. Case 4. If the candle is placed between C and F, then we will get the image beyond the C. The size of the image is enlarged and nature is real and inverted. Case 5. If the candle is placed at F, then the image will be seen to be formed at infinity, highly enlarged in size and real and inverted in nature. Case 6. In the last case, if the candle is placed between F and P, then the image will not be formed on the screen, but it will appear to be formed behind the mirror as in the case of convex mirrors. Size will remain enlarged and nature will be virtual and erect.
So friends, by this activity, we can conclude that a concave mirror can form any kind of image, erect or inverted, real or virtual, large or diminished.
In most cases, the concave mirrors converge the light at a point. Hence, they are also called converging mirrors. In the same way, convex mirrors diverge, so are called diverging mirrors.
Due to the converging nature, concave mirrors are commonly used in torches, searchlights, and vehicles' headlights to get powerful parallel beams of light. They are also used as shaving mirrors to see larger images.
I hope you have found this video really interesting and have learned new things from this as well. So it's time for me to leave. Till then, you can have a look at this table. Bye. Light. Ever wondered what light is? And what is its effect on our lives? Through this and some upcoming videos, we will try to find out answers to the similar questions. Let's take an example. We are able to see a whole lot of things in the world around us, but we are unable to see things placed in a dark room, right? Why does this happen? Exactly. The answer is light. During the daytime, light rays from the sun get reflected when they fall on objects. This reflected light rays on entering our eyes enable us to see these objects. Image formation by mirrors,
twinkling of the stars,
various shining faces of the moon, appearance of rainbow after the rain. All these are possible due to light only. Without light, we won't be able to see any of these phenomena. We have already read in our 7th and 8th grade about the nature of light and how light rays travel and form images on plane mirrors.
Let's recall the laws of reflection.
Number 1. The angle of incidence is always equal to the angle of reflection. Number 2. The incident ray, the normal to the mirror at the point of incidence, and the reflected ray all lie in the same plane. Along with that, we are also familiar with the properties of the image formed by plane mirrors. Number 1. The image formed by the plane mirror is always virtual and erect. Number 2. The size of the image formed is always equal to the size of the object. Number 3. The image formed is as far behind the mirror as the object in front of it. Number 4. The image formed is laterally inverted. If the plane mirror is replaced by the spherical mirror, will the characteristics of the image change? Let us try to understand the spherical mirror through this activity.
My name is Rahul, and today I will learn about image formation with the help of this shiny spoon. Hey, as I'm taking the spoon away, the size of my image is getting smaller. What? Why is my image inverted in the spoon? What if I turn the spoon over? Here also the size of the image is getting smaller, but it is erect, not inverted as it was in the first case.
Could you think why this would have happened to Rahul? The shape of the spoon is spherical, not plane. Those mirrors which have spherical reflecting surfaces like the spoon, in this case, are called spherical mirrors. The small and inverted appearance of the image are two of the characteristics of the image formed by spherical mirrors. Why are they called spherical mirrors? Let us understand why. Take a large sphere and cut it in such a way that we get spherical arc-like shapes. These shapes can be polished in either of the ways to make a mirror. If the reflecting surface of the mirror is tilted inwards and towards the center of the sphere, then it is called a concave mirror. And the mirror whose reflecting surface is tilted outwards is called a convex mirror. Let us try to understand the spherical mirror with another activity.
Hello friends, I came again. Now I will show you something with the help of a magical activity. A concave mirror and a paper would be needed to perform it. I will place the concave mirror in such a way that the rays of the sun after getting reflected by it directly falls on the paper. I will keep on doing this process while moving the paper back and forth until a sharp point of light is made on the paper. After some time, we could see the paper smoldering and the smoke coming out of it. Why would this have happened? This is because the concave mirror focused the light coming from the sun in one place. And in science, this point is known as focus of the concave mirror. Another interesting fact about spherical mirrors is that in the case of concave mirrors, the focus lies in front of the mirror, while in the case of convex mirrors, the focus lies behind the mirror. As we know, that a spherical mirror is the part of a sphere and every sphere has a center. This center is known as the center of curvature of that spherical mirror. If a line is drawn from the center of curvature and focused to the mirror, it will always pass through the center point of the mirror, which is known as pole. This line is called the principal axis. and the distance from the center of curvature to the pole is called radius of curvature. The distance between the focus and the pole is known as focal length, and the circular distance is called aperture. One should keep in mind that radius of curvature is twice the focal length. Like focus, all these points lie in front of the concave mirror and at the back of the convex mirror.
Let's move forward. We have already discussed the spherical mirror and its terminology. Today we will discuss representation of images formed by mirrors and the cases of convex mirrors. You must be familiar with some of these pictures cited from your book, where image formation is shown with the help of ray diagrams. To understand these diagrams, we have to remember the rule of 2 plus 4, where 2 is the number of rays and 4 is the number of cases. To make any ray diagram, we need 2 rays of light, which could be taken from any of these 4 cases. Case 1. If the ray of light travels parallel to the principal axis, after reflection, it will pass through the focus of the concave mirror or appears to diverge from focus of the convex mirror. Case 2. If the ray of light passes through the focus of the concave mirror or appears to move towards the focus of the convex mirror, it will emerge parallel to the principal axis after reflection. Case 3. If the ray of light passes through the center of curvature of the concave mirror or appears to go towards the center of the curvature of the convex mirror, it will travel back from the same path after reflection. Case 4. If the ray of light falls obliquely to the principal axis towards the pole, then it will be reflected back obliquely, making an equal angle to the principal axis. Now Rahul will show you an activity for how the image is formed by a convex mirror. To understand the image formation by convex mirror, a convex mirror and a pencil will be required. Hold the mirror like this in one hand and place the pencil in front of the mirror in the other hand. Now look carefully in the mirror. We will see a small and erect image, and as the pencil continues to move closer towards the pole, the image appears to move towards the pole from the focus. But the size remains small, so it can be concluded that a convex mirror always makes a diminished and erect image. If we talk about the ray diagrams, then only 2 cases can be possible for convex mirror. Case 1. Position of the object at infinity. If the object is placed at infinity, the rays will travel parallel to the principal axis, then get diverged on falling to the mirror, and the image appears to be formed behind the mirror. The size of the image formed is very small, and its nature is virtual and erect. Case 2. In the second case, the position of the object will be in between the infinity and the pole. In this case as well, the rays of light will be diverged after reflection. But from the rule of 2 plus 4, the image appears to be formed behind the mirror between the pole and the focus. Here too, the image is smaller in size than the object and virtual and erect in nature.
Convex mirrors are used as rear view mirrors in cars, buses, etc., as they form diminished and erect images.
So through this video, we were able to know what reflection is and how the spherical mirror reflects. We have seen the reflection through a convex mirror. In the upcoming video, we will learn how reflections takes place in case of concave mirrors. Hello friends, welcome back. What? You didn't recognize me? I am your friend Rahul. We have learnt a lot together in the past. Till now, we have understood what are spherical mirrors, how the images are formed by them. We drew ray diagrams, discussed the size and nature of the image, and also marked the points like C, F, P. Talked even about various distances like R and F. This distance, the size, can we make a math formula out of all these values? Yes! A relation has been observed among these distances, which is also known as mirror formula. According to the law of mathematics, it is advisable to understand the sign convention before using the formula. According to the new Cartesian sign convention, it is necessary for us to know 5 rules.
1. Let P of the mirror be placed at the O of the coordinate system.
Number 2. the object will always be placed to the left of the mirror. That means the light coming from the object will always fall from the left side of the mirror. Number 3. All distances parallel to the main axis will be measured from the pole. Number 4. All distances to the right of the origin point will be considered positive and all distances to the left will be negative. Number 5. The distances perpendicular to and above the main axis will be positive and the distances below will be negative.
The distance of the object from the pole is known as the object distance and the distance of the image is known as image distance, is represented by the symbol U and V. If focal distance is represented by F, then the relation of these three quantities is known as mirror formula. This formula is valid for all types of spherical mirrors. Only the new Cartesian sign convention needs to be taken care of.
The object distance will always be negative as the object is placed to the left of the mirror.
In mirror, distance of real image is taken as negative and distance of virtual image is taken as positive.
We see that sometimes the image is larger than the object and sometimes smaller. How large or small they are, along with the mirror formula, another relation is very important, which is called magnification. Magnification is the ratio of the height of the image to the height of the object, which tells us how many times the image is larger or smaller with respect to the object. Magnification is represented by M. We can also represent it in terms of object and image distance. You must have read in your books that magnification is negative for a real image and positive for a virtual image. Why? Have you ever thought of it? If we notice, we will get to know that real images are always inverted and virtual images are always erect. And we already know the symbols of the inverted and erect images. This is also the reason for the sign of magnification of real and virtual images. Here this video ends with the topic. I hope you have liked it. Now I'll have to leave as I need to go to my friend Aisha to discuss the next topic for the video. So see you in the next video. Bye. Take care. Eyeglasses. We commonly see eyeglasses on a daily basis. Have you ever seen eyeglasses closely? Have you ever tried to feel their lens with your hands? Do they have similar thickness throughout? The answer is no. Lenses are not uniform throughout, but thicker in the middle and thinner at the edges, or sometimes vice versa. So what is the reason for this variation in thickness? What will happen if light passes through this lens? Would it be called reflection or refraction? The answer is simple. Refraction, because the lens is transparent. Now if refraction is taking place, does it also have some rules? You will get answers to some of these similar questions through today's video. What is lens? First of all, we need to know what these lenses are. There are broadly two types of lenses. One is converging lens and the other one is diverging lens. Like mirrors, the lenses which converge the light are called converging lenses and the lenses which diverge the light are called diverging lenses. Types. Convergent and divergent lenses are broadly of six types. Double convex, plano convex, converging meniscus, double concave, plano concave and diverging meniscus. These lenses are called spherical lenses. Out of these six types of lenses, we will only talk about two in our upcoming videos. Double convex and double concave. They are usually known as convex lenses and concave lenses. Formation. Like spherical mirrors, these lenses are also made from the arc of the sphere. The difference is that another arc of glass is bounded with the first one in place of polishing it from one side and a transparent material is filled in the middle. As we know that every distance in case of mirrors was taken from P. Here in lenses, every distance is taken from O, which is also called optical center of the lens. As they have two surfaces, they have two focuses too, which are represented by F1 and F2. Twice the distance from O to F1 and F2 are called 2F1 and 2F2 respectively. And just like a mirror, all these points are found on the principal axis. Rules of image formation. Do you remember the 2 plus 4 rule of the mirrors? There are only 3 cases in lenses. In case 1, if the ray of light is traveling parallel to the principal axis, after refraction, passes through the focus located on the other side of the convex lens and appears to diverge from the focus located on the same side of the concave lens.
In case 2, if the ray of light passes through the focus of the convex lens or appears to go towards the focus of the concave lens, then after refraction, it will emerge parallel to the principal axis.
In case 3, if the ray of light passes through the optical center, then after refraction, they will emerge without any deviation. Now a question may be arising in your mind that the light was refracted on two different surfaces of the lens, but why this deviation is not shown here? The question is absolutely right. There will be refraction on both the surfaces of the lens, but lenses we take into consideration are too thin. That's why a straight line in place of deviation is shown here. Image formation by concave lens. Let us use these rules in this activity. Through this activity, we will get to know the refraction of light through a concave lens. To perform this activity, we need a concave lens having a focal length of 15 cm, a sheet, a candle, and a screen. Remember, in the case of a convex mirror, we can only place the object in two places. But here, because of having two surfaces, we can place the object in different places. Let's try it. First of all, a straight line must be drawn on the sheet and a point is placed in the middle of the line, which will be named O. All the distances will be taken from this point. F1 and F2 should be inscribed at a distance of 15 cm from O and 2F1 and 2F2 at a distance of 30 cm. In the first case, let's put the candle at infinity. Do we see any image on the screen? No! This means that the concave lens creates a virtual image in this case. If we remove the screen and look, we can find that the image is made at the focus on the first side, which is highly diminished in size and erect. In the second case, if we bring the candle a little closer from infinity, what will happen? We will not see any image on the screen. Then slowly bring the candle closer to O. Even then, nothing is visible on the screen.
So it would be correct to conclude that no matter what the case, concave lenses always form virtual images.
If we remove the screen and see, we can find that the image seems to be forming somewhere between F1 and O. The image is diminished in size and erect as well. The summary of image formation for both the cases of concave lenses is given in this table. Concave lenses are used to make eyeglasses. Also, they are used as lenses of flashlight. We will learn about eyeglasses in the following chapters. Through this video, we have learnt about various types of lenses, nomenclature of various points of lenses, rules of image formation, and refraction by concave lenses. Hope you liked this video. We will meet in the next video. Hello friends, meet my friend Ayesha. Let me tell you, she is very intelligent.
Rahul, you are intelligent too, but you prefer someone to speak highly of you. Anyways, this time I scored more marks than you in physics.
Yes, that's why you are here today.
What is the name of the topic which we will be discussing today?
Today's topic name is refraction.
Till now, what have you learned, Rahul?
We have already learned about light, reflection, and how the rays of light get reflected by different objects. But Ayesha, there are some questions in my mind.
Like?
What will happen if those objects are not opaque but transparent? Will the light still be reflected? Will the rules of reflection still apply?
Will the rays still follow a straight line path?
In today's video, we'll discuss these questions and learn about a new phenomenon known as refraction. We'll do a very interesting activity to explain refraction, which we can do at our houses too. To perform this activity, we need a bowl, a coin and water. I put this bowl on the table and put the coin inside the bowl. Rahul, can you see the coin?
Yes.
Very good. Now slowly move backwards from the table until the coin is not visible. Can you still see the coin?
No.
Now I'm going to put water in the bowl without moving the coin from its position. Rahul, can you see any difference?
Yes, I'm able to see the coin. But how is it possible, Ayesha?
It is possible due to a phenomenon known as refraction. Firstly, the rays of light while entering your eyes were reflected by the coin. But when I filled this bowl with water, the rays entered your eyes were refracted and not reflected, due to which you could see the coin.
So did light change its path after refraction?
You get it right, Rahul. But to understand this concept in depth, we have to use this rectangular glass lab. To understand refraction of light through a rectangular glass lab, we need a glass lab, a white sheet and 4 oil pens. After placing the slab on paper, we make an outline which will help us further. Fix 2 oil pins vertically such that the line joining the pins is inclined to the edge. Try to see the images of both these pins from the other side. Fix the other 2 pins such that these 2 pins and the images of the first 2 lie on the same line. Remove the slab and the pins from the paper. Draw a line marking the first 2 pins with the pencil, which will intersect the slab at O. Do the same procedure on the other side and give this point the name O dash. Draw 2 perpendiculars at O and O dash. Name the angle formed between the lines and the perpendiculars as angle of incidence and angle of emergence. Here the angle of refraction will be formed instead of the angle of reflection. Produce a straight line from the marks of the first 2 pins. Then join O and O dash. A deflection can be seen between both the lines. Or it can be said that the ray of light changed its path while passing through the glass slab. This phenomenon of changing the path of light when passed through different transparent media is known as refraction of light. The incident ray, the refracted ray, and the normal to the interface of 2 transparent media at the point of incidence all lie in the same plane. The ratio of sine of angle of incidence to the sine of angle of refraction is a constant for the light of a given color and for a given pair of media. This law is known as Snell's law of refraction. The constant we get from the ratio is called refractive index. The extent of the change in direction that takes place in a given pair of media is expressed in terms of refractive index. In addition to it, the refractive index can also be represented by the relative speeds of light in different media. If the light is traveling from medium 1 to medium 2, and the speed of light in the first medium be V1, and in the second be V2, then the refractive index of medium 2 with respect to medium 1 is given by the ratio of the speed of light in medium 1 and the speed of light in medium 2. This is usually denoted by N21. Like this, the refractive index of medium 1 with respect to medium 2 is denoted by N12. If medium 1 is air or vacuum, then the refractive index is called absolute refractive index. Absolute refractive index is simply known as refractive index only. Vacuum and air are considered as rarer mediums. Some of the other materials are considered as denser mediums. You can check the refractive index of several material media with respect to air.
Wow, Ayesha, you have explained this topic very nicely. I didn't know that you are a great teacher too.
You get it right, Rahul. I want to be a teacher.
All right. Best of luck.
Thank you.
We shall meet you folks in our next video. Till then, bye-bye. Hello friends, I am your friend Rahul and I am back with this new video. Till now we have learnt about refraction by glass slab and concave lens. Now it is turn to learn about the refraction by convex lens. In today's video, we will do an activity to learn refraction by a convex lens in a better way.
To perform this activity, we need a convex lens with a focal length of 15 cm, a stand, a screen, a candle and a sheet.
Remember, we saw different cases of image formation through a concave mirror. Here too, we will do this activity in the same way. First of all, we draw a straight line on the sheet and mark a point in the middle and name it O. F1 and F2 are inscribed at 15 cm on either side of O. And 2F1 and 2F2 at a distance of 30 cm in the same fashion. Then place the lens on O and place the candle on one side of the lens and the screen on the other side.
Like in the case of a concave mirror, the object was kept at 6 different positions. Here as well, 6 different cases can be made.
The first at infinity, the second beyond 2F1, the third at 2F1, the fourth between 2F1 and F1, the fifth at F1 and the last between F1 and O. Case 1. If the candle is placed at infinity, the light coming from the candle will be parallel to the main axis and after refraction, the image will be formed at F2. The image will be highly diminished or point sized as well as real and inverted. Case 2. If the candle is placed beyond 2F1, after refraction, the image will be formed between F2 and 2F2. The image will be diminished as well as real and inverted. Case 3. If the candle is placed at 2F1, then the image will be formed at 2F2. But its size will be the same as the size of the candle as well as the nature will be real and inverted. Case 4. If the candle is placed between 2F1 and F1, then we will get image beyond 2F2. It will be larger in size and real and inverted in nature. Case 5. If the candle is placed at F1, then the image will be seen to form at infinity. The size of the image will be highly enlarged and the nature will be real and inverted. Case 6. In the last case, if the candle is placed between F1 and O, then the image will not be visible on the screen.
But it will appear that it is forming somewhere on the same side of the lens as the object. Size will remain large and nature will be virtual and erect. In this table, summary of image formation by convex lens is shown.
Convex lenses converge the light. They are used as magnifying lenses or camera lenses.
They are also used to correct defects of vision, which will be studied in the next chapter.
We have learnt so far about mirrors and lenses. Let's try to remember all the points by creating a comparison table. Number 1. In the case of mirrors, a glass piece is polished to make a mirror. And here, any transparent spherical piece of glass is known as spherical lens. Number 2. Mirror always reflects the light, but the lens refracts. Number 3. Mirror can either be spherical or plane. But in case of lenses, there has to be two surfaces. And either of them must be curved inwards or outwards. Number 4. Mirror works on the laws of reflection, whereas lens works on the laws of refraction. Number 5. There is only one focus and only one reflecting surface of the mirror, whereas in the case of a lens, there are two. So friends, in our next video, we will learn about the lens formula. Take care folks and keep watching our videos. Take care. Hello friends, this is your friend Rahul. Welcome you to this video. Today we will discuss the last topic of this chapter, We will learn about the lens formula, magnification, and power of the lens. We have already learned a lot about mirrors and lenses, such as how mirrors reflect and lens refract. Mirrors and lenses have some similarities as well as differences. If you remember, we have learned a mirror formula too. Just as the mirror formula shows the relationship between object distance, image distance, and focal length, similarly, the lens formula also shows the relationship between these three parameters. For any lens, the lens formula looks like this. Like the mirror formula, lens formula 2 have 5 sign conventions. Number 1. In the case of lenses, all the distances are taken from O, which is known as the optical center of the lens. Number 2. The object is always placed on the left side of the O, as it was used to be in mirror formula 2. Number 3. Distances on the left side of the O are always taken negative but positive on the right side. Number 4. All the distances above the principal axis are taken as positive and all the distances below the principal axis are taken as negative. Number 5. Focal length of convex lens is taken as positive but for concave lens it is negative. In the case of a mirror, it was clear that in a convex mirror, the focus is on the right side, so it is taken positive, and in the concave mirror on the left side, so it is negative. But the lens has two focuses, so how will we give the symbol? This point can be understood here. Convex lens converges the light coming. We know that convex lens after refraction converges the light on the focus, which is on the right side of the lens. This focus acts the principal focus in case of convex lens. Hence, the focal length is taken positive. Conversely, in the case of a concave lens, the light after refraction appears to be diverged from the focus, which is on the left side of the lens. Hence, the focal length is taken negative in this case. With the lens formula, there is another property which we know by the name of magnification. Like in case of a mirror, it is the ratio of the height of the image to the height of the object, which indicates how large or small the image is compared to the object.
This mathematical relation shows the magnification of the lens. It can also be represented in the form of the ratio of image distance to object distance. Let's move towards the next part of the video. You must have noticed people find it difficult to see distant or nearby objects clearly.
To these people, doctors suggest wearing eyeglasses. We must have heard from our friends who wear eyeglasses that the power of their eyeglasses are 2 or minus 1.5. What does this power mean? And how do these eyeglasses are made? We will get to know the answers to these questions in this part of the video. This is nothing but the power of the lens. This power signifies the ability of the lens to converge or diverge the light. It can be represented mathematically as the reciprocal of the focal length. The SI unit of the power is diopter, which is denoted by D.
1D is equal to 1 meter inverse.
We know that the focal length of a convex lens is positive. So the power of a convex lens is also positive. In contrast to the focal distance of a concave lens being negative, its power is also negative. And this is the reason that the power of the lens applied in the glasses is also positive and negative, which we will know in detail in the next chapter. Here this chapter ends. We will meet somewhere in the future. I would suggest you show these videos to your friends as well, because I believe knowledge is power and sharing is caring. Bye friends, take care.